Well, your mother was actually a singer.
Yeah.
She was part of the group Kitty and the Haywoods.
That's right. Damn, Vlad. You be on your shit, man. Yes. Yeah.
So she has some experience with the whole entertainment industry already.
Yeah.
So at one point, you wanted to get into entertainment yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So what was like the first few steps that went into that?
The first few steps, when I expressed the interest to want to get involved, she had reached out to a friend of hers at Burrell Communications, which was an advertising firm in Chicago, Illinois, headed up and founded by Tom Burrell. And Burrell Communications was pretty much the first black ad agency that would tailor and gear commercials and radio ads to the black audience. So they were the first ones to get the McDonald's campaigns, Coca-Cola, anything national and anything big, or any corporation that was trying to market or advertise their products to the black community in the 70s or the 80s. 9 times out of 10, they hired Burrell to construct and build those ads. So Burrell was headquartered in Chicago. And so essentially what Burrell did was employ and provide jobs to musicians, singers, and upcoming actors throughout the city of Chicago that were looking to enter into the game. And so a lot of us started off doing commercials. Carl Weathers was one of the actors, Carl Weathers that played Apollo Creed.
Right.
And Rocky, like, he was one of the people to benefit from that. I think Minnie Ripperton, like, one of her, I think she had done, like, a couple spots for them, like, early on in her career. And one of the families that they helped tremendously was mine. It helped to usher in, help kickstart my career. My cousin Tricky Stewart, who went on to become a Grammy Award winning music producer.
Right.
My other cousin, Koo Carell, 5-time Grammy Award winner, who's like the number one vocal producer in the world. All of us, my cousin Lainey Stewart, all of us came from that background, working alongside with Burrell, working in the jingle business and advertising in Chicago, doing commercials and spots. Yeah.
Okay, so you started doing commercials first.
Yep.
And then you started getting some television around 1990, I guess?
Yeah, my first role was a movie called The Long Walk Home, mm-hmm, with Whoopi Goldberg and Sissy Spacek. And it was critically acclaimed, but commercially it didn't do really that well. It was like, you know, it was a period piece. It was about the Montgomery bus boycott.
Mm. Okay.
It was beautifully written, beautifully shot, well directed. The acting in it was just tremendous, in my personal opinion, even now looking back in retrospect. But it just didn't connect with audiences like at that time. But it was an honor to be a part of that and to work with Whoopi and to work with Sissy Spacek, Ving Rhames. That was one of his first films. He played my dad in it.
Okay.
Erica Alexander. That was a great film to be a part of. So, yeah.
Okay, and you also did Brewster's Place.
Yeah.
Brewster Place.
Yeah, the television series, not the miniseries.
Right.
Because a lot of people get that confused. Yeah, did that with Oprah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Oprah, with a lot of other people in Chicago, people of color in Chicago, man, she provided a lot of opportunities, man, for black actors during that time when she had Harpo Studios up on the west side. She had Brewster Place going. So a lot of the people that were cast were like local hires and even, of course, members of the crew. But, you know, she employed a lot of people. Oprah looked out.
Yeah, I mean, I forgot how long Oprah's been acting. I mean,
since what, Color Purple?
Yeah.
And that was like 85?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's been putting in work.
Yeah, Oprah's
okay. So then you end up doing the Jacksons movie.
Yep.
The Jacksons and American Dream.
Yep.
It was a miniseries on TV.
It was a miniseries, yeah.
And that was really our first look into the Jackson story and the Michael Jackson story in particular.
Right.
You know, that's when you got to see Joe Jackson as a tyrant. Because before then, it was just totally a mystery.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you got to understand, like in 1990, Michael Jackson was the biggest thing on earth.
Damn right.
What album was out during that time? Was that?
It was Dangerous.
Dangerous.
I remember. Yeah, yeah. It was definitely Dangerous.
Okay, so you get cast to play young Michael Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
How much of an honor was that?
Man, insane. I mean, you know, even when people years later now, you know, I'm 40 years old, you know what I mean? Like, but to be given an opportunity like that at such a young age, and for it to still have the ability to resonate and like have that kind of long lasting appeal to where you have not only the generation that I grew up with during that period, but even a younger generation who were introduced to it through their parents, who now love it, and to portray, you know, such an iconic figure like Michael was just probably one of the most rewarding experiences of my life and career. Cause it did so much for me, as far as like growing as an artist and just growing as a person, understanding like how to deal with celebrity and fame, all of that within that American, dream experience, was just a major growth period for me, man. And just so rewarding in so many different ways. So shout out to the Jackson family. Shout out to Michael. Rest in peace. I really, really appreciate them for giving me that opportunity, man.
Well, I mean, I think every 10-year-old black kid on the planet wanted to play Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
In a big budget TV series like that.
Hell yeah, bro.
How did you get that role?
I auditioned like everyone else. Now, I will say I was given the heads up that the miniseries was going to be, or that they were going to be casting maybe like a couple weeks prior, because my cousin Lainey Stewart, who was producing a lot of stuff at like Sony and MCA at the time, he had a manager, Ruth Carson, who was a rep for DePass Entertainment, Suzanne DePass's company. And so Ruth was coming to Chicago and just hanging in the studio and happened to mention in conversation that they were going to be doing this miniseries about the Jacksons. So I was like, oh man, that sounds cool. It sounds exciting. She was like, yeah, you know, when I hear about it, you know, or when I know that they're casting, I'll inform you and your mom and, you know, you guys holler at your agent and see if you could submit. So sure enough, we did. Like a couple weeks later, when they officially started taking submissions, you know, we threw my name in the hat, through my agency, the Gettys Agency, with Elizabeth and Ann Gettys. I put myself on tape in downtown Chicago. I sang like, what, two of the Jackson songs. I think they wanted like ABC and I Want You Back. They wanted to hear that. And they wanted you to read the sides. And so I did that. They sent the tape out here to LA. And this was before, you know, the internet and all that stuff. So it's literally like FedExing and UPSing and messengering stuff. So it took maybe about, I'd say a week and a half, 2 weeks for them to get back to us. But when they got back to us, they were like, yo, we want to, you know, bring Jason out for a call back. And the rest just kind of transpired from there.
Right. Because this role requires someone not just to act, but to sing as well.
Yeah.
Now, how well could you sing Michael Jackson songs leading up to that?
I mean, being honest, the only Michael songs I knew were the songs that I grew up with.
Thriller,
the Thriller joints and like Bad and all of that. So as my mother was rehearsing with me and teaching me, giving me the history of the Jackson 5, I'm learning all of that as I'm learning these songs. So I'm like, oh, so Mike, like I knew about the Jackson 5 cartoon and because that would like, you know, come on after school or something. But other than that, I didn't know that Michael Jackson was like even a huge big star like back then as a kid. So I was, you know, just developing a whole newfound respect for him and his family as I was going along. And I mean, just thankfully for me, I just had a mom that understood what it took to be able to prepare for something like that. Cause she was a professional. So she was able to provide some real guidance and wisdom for me to where I can do this and execute it the right way. And come into it with like the level of discipline and focus that I needed.
I mean, can you still do the songs?
Can I still do them?
Yeah.
Hell no, not those.
Nah?
Nah, man. Because, I mean, even then, bro, that shit was high. Like, I remember.
Because you have somewhat of a high-pitched voice.
I have a natural high-pitched voice.
But not like a Michael Jackson high-pitched voice.
Nah. Nah, and then even with his speaking voice.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
It was like natural, like a natural low. He just was unique
in a sense. So his voice was more low?
Yeah. I mean, when I would hear him talk in like, whether it was seeing him or in front of him or in interviews, and when he would talk low, it was like, to me, it sounded like a regular, he had more bass in his voice than I do. I mean, and I know that probably sounds crazy to a lot of people, but he really did.
Okay. So was that series done with the Jackson family?
Yeah.
Okay. So they were heavily involved in it.
Oh, yeah. No. Jermaine Jackson was the executive producer alongside with his wife at the time, Margaret Maldonado. Michael had to pick who played him. So
he picked you.
Yeah. So, I mean, everybody that played Michael Jackson, Michael 1, 2, and 3, Michael had to personally select. Joe was there. Mrs. Jackson was there. Mrs. Jackson and Joe and Jermaine and Margaret were at my last audition before they sent the tape out to L.A. So they were there, you know, like encouraging me, and they kind of had to give their final approval to even send the tape to Michael. So, no, they were heavily involved because they wanted to make sure that their story was told from their perspective. That was during the time when everybody had their own perception of what the Jackson family was about, and everybody had their own theories, and they had never come out and told their story. So they just wanted to make sure that it was done right. So they even, you know, with Suzanne DePass being involved, making sure that that relationship being shown with Motown and Berry Gordy, that that was shown in an authentic way. Mr. Gordy came to set a couple times. Jermaine Jackson Jr. played Jermaine. It was a family affair. Like Janet and Tupac came to the set, like when they were shooting Poetic Justice. Like
right.
No, it was real. It was dope.